Good morning, everybody. There's quite a few items to get through. Unfortunately, with the sad news last night that we're all going into lockdown again, this will be the last service for at least the next month. There won't be any more services at all. I think Ian wanted to pass on the message that obviously there will be recorded services, but it does mean for the time being things are on hold. With regard to the tea room, it is looking like we may not be allowed to carry on with takeaway either. It is very dependent on what the Archdeacon and Bishop say, but the message from Neil Pugmire from the diocese last night that came through shortly after the announcement was made by Boris Johnson indicates that church buildings can only be used if they're going to be utilised as a food bank or for a public service. Having said that, we did secure a grant this week from Fareham Borough Council to continue providing free packed lunch boxes for children who need them for the next month. So I am going to be in touch with the Archdeacon to try and get some clarity on whether we can continue or not, and obviously we'll let you know. But at the moment, it looks as if the tea room probably will have to close as well. Unfortunately, this evening's spate of, I think it's the beginning of Ian's talks in the parish hall this evening, they're actually being cancelled as well, because what Ian didn't want to do was start one this evening and then have a huge gap, so he's decided to cancel that as well. So if you do know anyone who is due to be coming who's not at this service, Ian is going to try and get hold of them by phone, but if you could pass the message on, that would be much appreciated. On a more positive note, it's All Saints Day and we do have incense. So the good thing is you've all got your masks today, so it should be a bit easier to stop it filtering through the nasal passages. So yeah, incense. So if anyone is not keen or needs to be near the door, then just to warn you. Obviously, I can't really give you a lot more information. Things are in the very early stages. Whether or not we will be able to open for private prayer, it's all up in the air at the moment. So as soon as we do get some clarity, then obviously we'll put it out in notices and we'll let you know. Finally, at the back of the church, there are the brown envelopes. There is one for everybody, and it contains all the information for the new parish giving scheme. For those of you who were at the APCM, you'll be aware of it, but there is an envelope at the back for everybody to have a look at. And if you want any help or clarification with it, Emma at the office, and she still will be available on the phone even if the office is closed, can go through it with anybody. So thank you.
By God's grace we were blessed to have heroes strong and true, shining bright through our long and weary nights. Even now they are near, in our hearts they shine anew, still abiding, ever guiding us to love.
Still abiding, ever guiding us. We're now going to open with the hymn For All the Saints as we celebrate the power and the glory of God with them in his presence. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Would you please sit? A very warm welcome to our worship, a poignant day in the light of the Prime Minister's plans for the nation and church worship over the next month being suspended, subject to parliamentary approval. Are able to celebrate with joy today, to make a memory, as we might say in the Navy. That's one of the things that we do, make memories. of the glory of God as seen more closely by the saints and has reflected in their lives. If anyone's visiting, we're apologetic that there is no coffee today, but please do make yourself known to us and have a chat outside the church. And apologies from Father Ian, who this morning turned two, but unfortunately has got some kind of virus, so needs a day of rest and recuperation. As we come to God's altar to remember him, his saints before him, the great cloud of witnesses, we remember those whose lives have inspired us, whose teaching has guided us, and whose prayers have helped us. As we come to God's presence now, we join our prayers with theirs to the throne of God's grace. As we pray together, and as the young people go out to the junior church if they would like to, we say together the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We acknowledge that, unlike God's choice saints, we are just average disciples. Seldom very evil, rarely very loving. We make our way through the streets and businesses of life, and at times along lonely byways, trying to give our best, yet rarely achieving half the good which we intended. Too often we skirt around the obstacles of evil rather than challenge their existence. We are polite when we should be angry and apologetic when we should be definite. We read of the saints and feel uplifted, and for a few hours inspired to reach higher. But too often the indifference of the society in which we live dampens our spirits and dissipates our energy. We remember loved ones whose faithfulness once lit our path and whose steadfast love warmed our hearts. Yet we admit her, our own light flickers and our love becomes lukewarm. May Almighty God have mercy upon you, forgive you your sins, bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those inexpressible joys which you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the Revelation to John. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne, and around the elders, and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne, and worshipped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God for ever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle reading is from the first letter of John, chapter 3. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself, just as he is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
We stand to hear the gradual hymn, "O Church, Arise and Put Your Armour On."
O Church, arise and put your armour on. Hear the call of Christ our Captain. For now the weak can say that they strong in the strength that God has given, with shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's light, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. Come as the Son of God is stricken, then see his robes lie crushed beneath his feet. For the conqueror has risen, and as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day every eye and heart will see. Strengthen every strife, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful.
The Lord be with you.
And
hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, O Christ. May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. On the 10th of October, something quite amazing happened in Assisi. Pope Francis beatified this 15-year-old young man, a boy from Milan called Carlo Acutis. What was different about him that the Pope has set him on his way to canonization, to becoming a saint? Well, the short and simple answer is that although Carlo died in 2006 of leukemia, in this year, in February, in Brazil, a young boy was cured from a pancreatic disease through his prayers. And it's an interesting fact that saints have been associated with works of healing since the early Christian times. And that was really how they came to be revered, because it was believed through their prayers others were blessed. Carlo, as you can see, was a young man very much like others of his age. He loved football, video games, and computers, and he mastered coding, whatever that is, at a very young age. Aside from being associated with this miracle, Carlo meets two of the most important criteria to become a saint. Whilst he loved life, he loved God most. And what he said provoked other people to love God too. Here are just two of that young man's sayings. Our destiny must be what is infinite, not what is finite. Infinity is our homeland. All are born with their own originality, but many live as photocopies. Where Carlo has been really exceptional was in his devotion to this Eucharist, the sharing of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, the food that takes us to heaven. He attended Mass daily, he persuaded his mother to do the same, and he spent his money on sleeping bags for the homeless, and at night would give them hot chocolate. But Carlo's greatest work, and the reason why he has drawn the attention of the world and of the Pope, is one piece of work. For 2.5 years, he persuaded his family to research the miracles associated with this sacrament. He gathered all kinds of stories, which are available on the internet on his website, to demonstrate how God changes our world, how he turns our world from apathy to passion, how he turns our world from darkness to light, from evil to good. Out of the construction of his website, Carlo created an exhibition that has been showcased in thousands of Catholic parishes across all 5 continents and in more than 100 universities. In one short life, a 15-year-old man has influenced millions. And it's being proposed that Carlo become the patron saint of the internet. Carlo is a help to us, I think, in our understanding of saints on this All Saints Day, because he's not the kind of person that we would expect to be a saint. So for me, he prompts us to unravel the stereotype and to rethink what we think about holiness. Think for a moment of Salisbury Cathedral, that majestic example of Gothic architecture that's one of the landmarks of Great Britain, probably one of the wonders of the world. Incidentally, they marked the 800th centenary during lockdown, unfortunately not in the way expected, but with a radio broadcast in which they were able to celebrate the story, a remarkable story, of the cathedral's founding and its history. You will very likely, like me, have stood at the west end of Salisbury Cathedral on the exterior and looked up to see that extraordinary panoply of saints from across the ages. There are 79 of them. Some of them have been there since the 13th century. Others have been replaced in the 19th century and the 20th century. At the very top is Christ in majesty. Beneath him, the angels, the apostles, the evangelists, the martyrs, the teachers, the virgins. And as we descend to the bottom, those saints known to us here in the south of England, people like Thomas a Becket, Edmund, Alphage, Alban, and locally to Salisbury, George Herbert. These are the people we expect to be saints. Distinguished scholars, kings, valiant martyrs, and vulnerable girls.
These are the people who loved God with all their hearts, their souls, and their minds, that others revered and held in honour. These are the people who have shown us the height, the length, the depth, and the breadth of God's love. But the danger is that we think saints are of different stock, a rare breed, unlike you and me, locked in the distant memory of the church with different DNA. And the beauty of Carlo is that he is ordinary. He is human. He is someone who has been in our era, in our world, in our culture, and is normal. And in his normality, points us to divinity. In today's Gospel, we hear one of the most important teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Gospel, the beginning of his Sermon on the Mount. The numbers of people following Jesus were so great that he needs to go up to a high place in order to be seen to address them. And Matthew very helpfully distills that teaching into three chapters in his Gospel, from chapters 5 to 7. And if someone were to ask you, how could you tell me what the teaching of Jesus is in the simplest possible way? There we have it, in those three chapters, 5 to 7 of Matthew's Gospel. So here we begin the Sermon on the Mount. This is the moment that Jesus has been waiting for to convey to his people his main message. It's like Moses going up to Sinai to bring down the law. Jesus goes to the mountain in order to give his instructions, his key messages. Following the Beatitudes, he goes on to talk about how Christians need to live, how we deal with money, prayer, simplicity of life, and most importantly, how we are not to judge others. And at the end of that sermon, the impact is amazing. His teaching made a deep impression on the people because he taught them with authority, unlike their own scribes. Interestingly, our church has the Beatitudes on the walls, created by Richard and Margaret Adams. So please do, in this season of remembrance, check them out. Perhaps see them as places to stop and to pray or to meditate on a particular one. Let's think about these Beatitudes, these characteristics of those who are to be near to God. The first four are different to the second four. The first four are all about suffering, the world that surrounds the Christian. Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the gentle, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. I suspect many Jewish jaws dropped when Jesus said those words. There were no simple instructions. Actually, he was making life far more complicated. He was opening their eyes to a different economy of salvation. He was showing them that the way to God is not by worrying about the minutiae of the law and having everything precisely correct, but is seen in relational terms, one person to another, one person vulnerable to another. And the vulnerability begins with poverty, the poor in spirit. Isaiah the prophet had foretold 6 centuries previously that the Messiah would bring good news to the poor, a word that can be easily translated as broken-hearted or broken in spirit. This is where it begins. For the Jews of the time, this was news, because they had been believing that success in God's eyes would be about the wealthiness of their crops, the effectiveness of their herds, enjoying peace and wealth, prosperity. But here, Jesus turns that completely on its head. He reverses their expectations and makes them think again about a reality that they perhaps knew in their heart of hearts but had not dared admit. So Jesus speaks of a world where the last will be first, where the brokenhearted, the gentle, the mourners, and the political agitators, often the victims of abuse, come first. The second set of Beatitudes perhaps causes us a sigh of relief, because here Jesus is talking about things we might do. Be merciful, be pure in heart, be peacemakers, be persecuted, and do it properly, without judging. The saints are important to us because they grasp their need of God in the here and now. Not for them is the reward of the Pharisees' long, hard slog. Rather for them, heaven is found on earth. Heaven is found between us, between you and me, between us and our neighbour, between us and our colleagues, in the street, in the home, in the workplace. To begin with, poverty is about seeing the poor, not ignoring them. It's about speaking to the poor and listening to the poor. As Mother Teresa said, the greatest poverty is in the West, and that poverty is loneliness. I wonder where we are in our engagement with poverty, the very basis of life, the awareness of the needs of our neighbours, the awareness of the loneliness of our neighbours, and how we try to engage with sensitivity and love. If we were more saintly, more like Carlo Acutis, we'd want to find the Christ in the places where he is being found, where Jesus said he himself would be. You remember Matthew 25, I was sick and you visited me, I was naked and you clothed me. We often see the homeless as a threat rather than a potential friend. Perhaps if we took away one thing from the Sermon on the Mount, it might be to speak to a homeless person, to show that sign of compassion, that sign of Christ's love. To speak to the shy who make us awkward, to go out of our way to support the bereaved. These are the places where there's blessing. There's a striking feature about that great west end of Salisbury Cathedral. It's where the stonemasons placed the Blessed Virgin Mary. And if you consider the spiritual culture of the time, the devotion to the Blessed Virgin, the dedication of the cathedral to her honour, one would expect her to be placed beneath the feet of her son in majesty. Mary is at the bottom. Mary is over the west door, holding on her knee the infant Jesus. She is there to remind you, as you enter that place of God, that the way to God begins with the incarnation, with the taking flesh of God himself, that miracle of earthing our faith, of bringing down heaven to earth, is the reason he came, in order that the saints, the apostles, the martyrs, and all those who have loved God with heart, soul, and mind might pave the way to that heavenly kingdom. Through his taking flesh, he has opened the door of heaven to all who believe and trust in him. Carlo Acutis found him in this most holy sacrament, the source and summit of salvation, the place where God may be found. In the words of the poet Francis Thompson, O world invisible, we view thee. O world intangible, we touch thee. O world unknowable, we know thee. Inapprehensible, we clutch thee. Yea, in the night my soul, my daughter, cry, clinging to heaven by the hems. And lo, Christ walking on the water, not of Gennesareth, but of Thames. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We now stand to profess our faith in the Creed of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us pray to God the Father through Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit, who laughs with us and weeps with us and lavishes his love on us and calls us to be his witnesses. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer with our longings, our uncertainties, our hopes and our fears. Lord, help us to be faithful, to trust you today, tomorrow, and for whatever the future holds. Help us with all the saints to follow the vision of your kingdom in the light of Christ. Father, may your Holy Spirit lead us, your people, your church throughout the world, to show and to share the good news of your love, compassion, joy, hope, justice, and peace. And in this lockdown, in the restrictions that we now face, we may not meet physically for worship, but may we trust in your loving spirit to hold us together in your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world and all its peoples. We pray for our Queen and government and the heads of all nations, that they may find God's ways of goodness to serve one another and to seek the common good. Bless all those who reach out and show your love, justice, and compassion to the hurting, the poor and the needy. Even those who do not know you, who are called to show your love, may they know the refreshment of Christ's way of your unfailing love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the concerns of all in our communities, suffering fear and anxiety in so many ways at this time, from all aspects of hardship because of the pandemic. Open our eyes, Lord, to the wealth of your love, to share in community. Bring in your compassion and wisdom, light and hope. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who recently were cruelly killed because of wars, malevolence, and the blindness of terrorism. And we pray for those who grieve. Also, we pray for those who have suffered as a result of the recent earthquake in Egypt and any such disasters. Bring light and hope and peace. Lord, in your mercy. Yeah. Heavenly Father, we long for the young in our communities and fellowship to know your love and your ways, to grow in the knowledge that Jesus is Lord, and that he lights the way and shows a way of your joyful purposes for their lives and for all life. Bless with wisdom and encourage all those who guide these youngsters, and also those who lead all others in the study of your purposes through such courses as the Alpha and any opportunities to share in the study of your word of truth. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the sick and the dying, for those affected by the COVID-19 virus, those ill in hospital, at home or in care homes, for their families. And we pray for doctors and nurses and staff who look after the sick. Bless them with your patience, your skills, and your love, and bring comfort and healing. We pray for those who have asked for our prayers. We pray especially at this time for those who are ill or recovering: Maureen Raven, Gus Moody, Sadie Batley, Cynthia Martin, Brian Smith, Jackie Wheatley, and any others known to us personally. We pray also for the lonely, especially as we go more into isolation. We pray for the mentally distressed, the homeless, and the refugee. Comfort and bring healing. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the upcoming election for the President of the United States of America. May your wisdom and insight guide the electorate and all the people of the U.S. May your will and purposes be the power that overrides any outcome. For you, Lord, are the God of love and of all power and might. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for the leaders of your church here in this diocese, and in this place, for Bishop Christopher, for Ian, especially as he is unwell at this time, as area dean and our vicar. We pray for all who assist him in ministry in this place. Fill all of us called to serve, all of us called to be saints, your witnesses. May we be filled with your love and wisdom. Inspire and enlighten us by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand? We are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off and those who were near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a socially distanced peace. Peace be with you.
The offertory hymn, "Ye servants of God, your master proclaim." The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Give it up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. We rejoice in the glorious splendour of your majesty, for you have given us a share with all your saints in the inheritance of the saints in light. In the darkness of this passing age, they proclaim the glory of your kingdom. Chosen as lights in the world, they surround our steps as we journey on towards the city of eternal life, where they sing the everlasting song of triumph. In communion with angels and archangels and all who have served you on earth and worship you now in heaven, we raise our voices to proclaim your glory, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints, we may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. God, the source of all holiness and giver of all good things, may we who have shared at this table as strangers and pilgrims here on earth be welcomed with all your saints to the heavenly feast on the day of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Closing hymn, Who Are These Like Stars Appearing? May I take this opportunity to wish you well during these coming weeks, to know God's blessing differently, to know the fellowship of the Christian family differently, and to know that God loves you differently. May Christ, who has made saints of sinners, who has transformed those we remember today, raise and strengthen you, that you may transform the world, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.